Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Sign of the Sinister Sorcerer, a John Bellairs mystery by Brad Strickland, narrated by George Guidall. Chapter 1.
"Ladies and gentlemen," announced Jonathan Barnevelt in a cheerful boom, "for my next trick, I shall require the assistance of a volunteer from the audience. Who wants to be my victim? I mean, my helper?"
Sitting in the backyard of 100 High Street, with a bunch of his classmates, Louis Barnevelt couldn't help grinning. It was a June day in the mid-1950s, and in the town of New Zebedee, Michigan, school had just ended. To celebrate, Louis's uncle Jonathan was throwing a party for Louis and some of his classmates, and the cheerful red-haired, bearded, pot-bellied Uncle Jonathan was performing one of his slightly unusual magic acts. Meanwhile, their next-door neighbor, the thin, gray-haired Mrs. Florence Zimmerman, was filling a long picnic table with delicious snacks and refreshments. In a way, that was funny, because while Louis's uncle was a real, honest-to-goodness wizard who could create realistic illusions, the friendly, wrinkly-faced Mrs. Zimmerman was a powerful, good witch whose magic was far greater than Jonathan Barnevelt's. However, while Louis's uncle could easily entertain a dozen or so school kids, he couldn't cook a decent dish to save his life. Fortunately, Mrs. Zimmerman was not only a sorceress, but also a fabulous cook. Sitting next to his friend Rosarita Pottinger, Louis squirmed around to look hungrily over his shoulder as Mrs. Zimmerman set down a tall, four-layered chocolate frosted cake, its glossy brown icing making Louis's mouth water. Then Mrs. Zimmerman, who was wearing one of her light summer dresses, purple, of course, because she loved that color, began to decorate the cake with sweet red maraschino cherries. Suddenly, Rosarita poked Louis in the side with her elbow. "Pay attention!" She was a skinny, rather plain girl with long, stringy black hair and big, round, horn-rimmed glasses, and when she hit you with her sharp elbow, it hurt. "Okay, okay," mumbled Louis, and though his stomach was growling, he turned his gaze back toward the temporary stage his uncle had built in the backyard from 2x4s and plywood. Though he was no expert at carpentry either, Uncle Jonathan had done a pretty good job this time. The platform looked sturdy enough, and Mrs. Zimmerman had draped it with festive red, white, and blue crepe paper streamers. "Now, David," said Uncle Jonathan to his shy volunteer, David Keller, one of Louis's few real friends at school, "I don't know you at all, do I?" "Huh?" David asked in surprise, and the other dozen or so kids hooted with laughter. "All right, maybe I know you," said Uncle Jonathan with a wink. "But I'll bet you if you name any object, I can find it in your pockets or, as a last-ditch effort, in mine." He made a swirling bow. Since Uncle Jonathan, for a change, was not wearing his familiar blue work shirt and khaki wash pants, but a tuxedo, rather tight around his round belly, a black top hat, and a black silk cloak lined with white satin, his bow looked elegant and sweeping. "Name anything at all," encouraged Uncle Jonathan, holding up his battered old cane dramatically. "Doesn't matter. Anything, however outrageous. Think up something you don't believe I'll be able to find in 1,000,000 years, 2 months, and 11 days. David shifted from foot to foot, his face red with embarrassment at being up in front of everyone. An elephant, he said, finally, stuttering a little. "An elephant," shouted Uncle Jonathan. "A tall order, or at least a great big one. But prestidigitatio, pachydermatitis, and behold." He flourished his crystal-headed cane and waved it like a magic wand. "Now I say the magic words. Peanut in a trunk. And what is this I find in your shirt pocket?" David's eyes flew wide as Uncle Jonathan reached into his pocket and pulled out a balled-up gray silk handkerchief. His eyes got wider when Uncle Jonathan dropped the handkerchief softly onto the stage with a grand gesture and waved his cane over it. Something moved around under the silk, looking like a tennis ball. Then it grew larger, as though someone were blowing up a balloon. When Uncle Jonathan bent over and whisked the handkerchief away, everyone yelped in surprise. A tiny elephant, about the size of a white rat, was marching around in a circle on the stage. It wore miniature circus trappings, pink ostrich plumes, and a red leather harness. As everyone watched, it raised its little trunk and trumpeted, sounding like a kitten playing a kazoo.
"It's not real," someone exclaimed in derision. "It must be a toy." "David, are you trying to pull a fast one on us? Tell us, did you have a toy elephant in your pocket?" demanded Uncle Jonathan, sounding very serious.
No, replied David. "I didn't even have a real one."
Everyone laughed again at that, but Uncle Jonathan held up his hand for silence.
"Who said it wasn't real?"
Lewis and Rosrita turned around, looking at the kids behind them. One of them stood instead of sitting among the other kids in folding chairs, and he had his arms crossed and a smart-aleck kind of look on his face.
"It's Hal," murmured Rosrita with a rueful grin.
"Yeah," said Lewis.
Hal Everett was a new kid in town, and he had been attending their school for only the last few weeks of class. In that short time, Rosrita had developed something of a grievance against him because he had edged her out in their history class as the one with the highest average. She had wound up the year with an incredible 98.5 score. But when Hal Everett had transferred in, he had made perfect grades on every quiz and even on the final exam, so his average wound up being 100. As Rosrita had complained to Lewis, that didn't seem fair. She had been on board for the whole school year, and if she hadn't come down with a bad case of flu back in the winter and missed a whole week of class, she might have had 100 average, too. It was unlike Rosrita to hold a grudge, but Lewis almost regretted that he had invited Hal. He had only done it because when he finished handing out the invitations, he suddenly realized that, counting himself and Rosrita, there would be 13 kids at the party. 13! Sitting in study hall, he had hastily scribbled out another invitation. He was on his way to lunch, trying to think of someone to invite, when Hal caught up with him and said,
"Everyone tells me you're having a party."
"Kind of an end-of-school celebration," Lewis had explained.
Hal had sighed deeply.
"I wish I could do things like that."
"Why can't you?" Looking miserable, Hal had shrugged.
"New in town," he said, in a choked-up kind of voice.
"Don't know anybody." He looked away as if embarrassed.
"I don't suppose you've got room for me?"
And just like that, Lewis had given him the invitation. He felt sorry for Hal, even if Rosrita wasn't terribly fond of him. Now Lewis hoped that Hal wouldn't be too much of a smart aleck as Uncle Jonathan called him to the stage.
"Step up, step up," Uncle Jonathan was saying to Hal, and he moved through the crowd, a tall, skinny, pale kid with a grave, serious face. "Right up onto the stage," said Uncle Jonathan, in an encouraging tone. "All right, Mr. Doubting Thomas, if that is your real name."
"It's Hal Everett," said Hal, sounding a little irritable.
"I apologize, Mr. Everett." "All righty, then. I lift the small elephant like this." Uncle Jonathan bent over and retrieved the tiny animal. He held it in one hand as it waved its trunk. "And I hand you the silk handkerchief that concealed it. Now, I will ask you to hold all four corners of the silk together, making a kind of pouch. Two corners in your left hand, two in your right. Yes, that's good. Now, I'm going to place Jumbo Jr. here, very carefully, into the handkerchief. Very well. Now, bring all the corners together and hold your elephant in a bag, all right?"
Hal did as he was instructed, with David looking on curiously. The dangling silk pouch certainly looked as if it contained something alive. It moved restlessly, bulging and swinging gently. Uncle Jonathan raised his wand and intoned, "Transformatio Columbia Livia!" He nodded and then said, "Now, Hal, do you agree that you are holding the miniature elephant in that handkerchief?"
Hal shrugged. "Yeah, I guess so."
"And you think it may not be alive?"
Hal gave him a suspicious look.
"It has to be a toy." "Very well. Here, I will hold the corners of the handkerchief, and you just reach carefully inside and take out the toy elephant."
"Okay."
Lewis stretched his neck, wondering what his uncle was up to. His magic shows were never the same twice, and he rarely performed them for Lewis's friends because the kids had a way of talking about the shows that made their unsuspecting parents think that maybe Jonathan Barnefelt was a little more tricky than he seemed. Not very many people in town knew that he was a real sorcerer, and the ones who did were all members of the Capharnaum County Magician Society. Carefully, Uncle Jonathan took the corners of the handkerchief and held the pouch slightly open while Hal reached in and felt around. A puzzled look came into the boy's eyes. He reached farther in, and farther, and even farther.
The boys and girls watching the show started to giggle and point. Somehow, Hal was leaning way over, his whole arm inside the small pouch of the handkerchief, all the way up to the shoulder. It looked impossible, and really it probably was, reflected Lewis. That was his uncle's real magic at work. It was a warm day, but he shivered a little, remembering an evening some years before when Uncle Jonathan had performed one of his best tricks for Lewis and a boy named Tarby Corrigan. Uncle Jonathan had eclipsed the moon, creating a weird, magical darkness that no one outside of the backyard of 100 High Street even noticed. All sorts of strange things had happened in that uncanny darkness, and one of them was that Lewis got the idea to imitate his uncle and try a magic spell that ended disastrously. Ever since, Lewis had felt very timid about trying to do magic himself. Up on the stage, Uncle Jonathan said encouragingly, "It's in there somewhere. Reach a little deeper. Be gentle, though." "Hey!" Hal pulled his arm out. He was holding something gray, but it wasn't an elephant. Looking surprised, Hal opened his hand, and a pigeon flew away, cooing in its gurgly birdy voice. Uncle Jonathan shook the handkerchief 1, 2, 3 times, and it disappeared with a flash of light. "Now, what you pulled out of the handkerchief was alive, wasn't it?" asked Uncle Jonathan, stroking his gray-streaked red beard. Despite his apparent determination to hold on to his skepticism, Hal grinned shyly. "It was alive, but it wasn't an elephant." "Very well, test me. What do you think I couldn't possibly have inside my pockets?" Hal squinted and thought. "Helium balloons. Let's see." Uncle Jonathan swirled his cloak dramatically. Everyone oohed as inflated balloons rose from his flapping cape and floated up on the ends of long strings. Each balloon had a word printed on it in squiggly letters. A yellow one said, "Hmm," a red one, "But," a blue one, "It," a green one, "Wasn't," a purple one, "An," and an orange one, "Elephant." "Let 'em fly," shouted Uncle Jonathan, handing the balloons to David. A laughing David Keller let go of them one at a time. Each balloon flew up about 50 feet and then popped spectacularly. When the "But" balloon burst, it sent up a shower of red sparks. The others produced a cloud of fluffy royal blue feathers, a puff of lavender smoke, a glittering burst of golden particles, and a noise like a whoopee cushion that made everyone double up in laughter. Hal chuckled weakly, too, but he looked sheepish. Watching the spectacle, Lewis felt a wave of sympathy for the new kid, the outsider. Feeling that people were laughing at you was never any fun. "It's all right," said Uncle Jonathan, patting his pockets. "I think we got 'em all. Try saying something else to check. Say, that was the most fantastic magic trick I ever saw." Making a face that might have been a reluctant smile, Hal murmured, "That was the most fantastic magic trick I ever saw." No balloons. "Why, thank you," responded Uncle Jonathan, giving another impressive bow. He held his hand out, and pop, a shiny red top hat appeared in it. He handed this to David, then produced another one, this one bright blue. That one he gave to Hal. "I present you with genuine honorary magician's hats," he said. "Thanks for helping, and if any rabbits come out of those, don't let 'em loose in the house. A big round of applause for my assistants, please." Lewis clapped along with everyone else. But just then he noticed something, or rather someone, peeking around the corner of the garage. Someone dressed very strangely in a maroon-colored hooded robe, with the hood pulled up so that Lewis could not see the person's face. He leaned toward Rose Rita. "Who's that?" "Where?" asked Rose Rita. Lewis pointed, but found he was aiming his finger at empty air. The robed person had vanished. He blinked, wondering if this was part of Uncle Jonathan's act. It gave him a momentary creepy feeling, though. Uncle Jonathan said, "Now I see that Mrs. Immerman has just about finished loading up the table with a great feast of goodies that you are going to love, so maybe just one last quick trick. Rose Rita, come up here." With a grin, Rose Rita popped up from her seat and bounded onto the stage. She knew about Uncle Jonathan's real magic, and she trusted him not to hurt her. "What's a celebration?" asked Uncle Jonathan, "without a few fireworks?" "Rose Rita, you are going to help me give a magical fireworks show. Please, kids, don't try this at home. You might blow yourselves to kingdom come." First, Uncle Jonathan produced an empty goldfish bowl. Then he had Rosarita hold it on top of her head. "Now," he said, "what kind of fireworks do you like best, Rosarita?"
"Rockets," she answered at once.
And immediately, to gasps of awe, a dozen rockets shot up out of the empty goldfish bowl. Trailing streamers of colored smoke, they rose higher and higher until finally, with booms and bangs and kerpows, they went off one after the other, bursting into brilliant red, blue, and green stars.
"Someone else," yelled Uncle Jonathan over the din. "Let's keep it going."
"A Catherine wheel," someone called.
With a tap of the wand, a spinning spiral of sparks rose majestically from the bowl, spraying the audience with silvery fragments and making some of the kids yelp in alarm. But the sparks were not hot at all and evaporated an instant before they touched anything. The whirling wheel of sparks rose higher and higher and finally blew itself apart with a gratifying, stomach-tightening blast.
"Another!" yelled Uncle Jonathan. "Hurry!"
"Roman candles!" yelled Lewis.
He liked them because they didn't make much noise at all, and loud noises made him flinch.
Whoosh! Graceful balls of colored fire shot out of the bowl, one right after the other, and then curved back toward the earth, producing red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet smoke trails, and leaving a figure in the air that looked like a multicolored, symmetrical sketch of a gigantic willow tree.
"Now mine," said Uncle Jonathan. "I want to make Mrs. Zimmerman happy, so lots and lots of purple smoke."
Rosarita shrieked half in alarm, half in glee. A boiling cloud of thick and, yes, very, very purple smoke erupted from the bowl, spilled out, covered the stage, and poured into the audience. Everyone jumped up, but they had no chance to run, and in an instant the smoke had covered them all completely. For just a moment, Lewis was lost in purple murk. He held his breath, but when he had to breathe, he found that he couldn't smell the smoke at all. And it didn't choke him the way real smoke would have done. It was just as if he were breathing the fresh air of a summer's afternoon. And a moment later, he was. Everyone blinked. The smoke had just faded away. And the stage had vanished, along with all the magic props. Uncle Jonathan now stood wearing his familiar old blue shirt, red vest, and tan pants, and he stood not on a stage, but on the somewhat shaggy green grass of the backyard. Next to him, Rosarita stood uncertainly, her hands still raised over her head to balance a goldfish bowl that was no longer there.
"Thank you," said Uncle Jonathan, taking one of Rosarita's hands and leading her in a stage bow, and the kids clapped wildly.
A moment later, they were all clustered around him, firing questions and demands at him. "How did you? Was that really a? Will you show us how to?" And over, "Do it again." Politely but firmly, Uncle Jonathan declined to repeat any of his tricks. And as for explaining them, "Why," he said, "a magician swears an oath of secrecy. If a magician reveals his tricks, his toenails turn blue and play rock and roll music all night long, and I love to sleep too much for that. Come on, let's eat." At last, Lewis hurried over to the picnic table and filled up a plate. Soon he, Rosarita, and David were gobbling their goodies while sitting together on a big beach towel spread on the grass.
"That was a great show,"
David sighed happily, his face smudged with chocolate beneath his cardboard top hat.
"And this is great cake," returned Lewis.
He wasn't surprised. Mrs. Immerman's double fudge chocolate frosted cake was one of her specialties, and she made it only once or twice a year.
"Hal's not eating," pointed out Rosarita. Lewis glanced over. Hal Everett stood off by himself, his hands in his pockets. He was watching Uncle Jonathan and Mrs. Immerman intently, but he didn't move toward the table himself.
"We ought to make him feel more at home," said Rosarita.
Lewis looked at her in surprise.
"I thought you hated his guts," he said. "He kept you from getting the history medal."
"I don't hate him," sniffed Rosarita.
"I just don't think the school was very fair about it, that's all. He seems to be a nice enough guy. He took your uncle's ribbing well. Anyway, Hal's new in town, just like you were once, Lewis."
"And me too,"
put in David. His folks had moved into town not too long before, and they didn't know that the place they had bought, a local landmark called the Hawaii House, was haunted by an army of Hawaiian warrior ghosts. The family came close to being taken away by the night marchers, but luckily, Lewis and Rosarita had come to the rescue, along with their two grown-up magician friends.
"So we should make friends with him," finished Rosarita. "We can show him around this summer."
"I can't," David said.
My mom's taking me to visit my grandparents in Massachusetts all summer long. I won't be back until August.
Then the two of us will have to do it, said Rosrita decidedly. Maybe he likes baseball. We could play flies and grounders with him, or...
Lewis sighed. It did no good to argue when Rosrita took that tone. When she made up her mind to do something, she did it. She was more athletic than he was, and in the summer she was always trying to talk him into grabbing a bat or putting on a baseball glove. And if she wanted him to help make Hal feel welcome, well, he would help, that's all.
Fine, he said, but not before I finish this cake.
And he took another bite of the wonderful cake, and the sweet frosting melted in his mouth. By that time, he had forgotten all about the phantom-like hooded figure he had glimpsed a few minutes earlier. Chapter 2. The party took place on a Saturday afternoon. By the following Monday, Lewis had begun to feel as if he were out of school for a good long stretch. He welcomed the break. Not that he was a bad student, or that he hated school, far from it. Lewis was a sharp kid, very interested in science and math. In fact, he was something of a whiz at astronomy. He and his uncle even had their own telescope, a nifty 10-inch reflector, which meant that instead of using a big lens to peer at the stars and planets, it used a big concave mirror. It let him see the craters on the moon, the white polar caps on orange-red Mars, and the moons of Jupiter, which looked like a row of bright little stars that were usually very close to the planet. However, after a long school year, Lewis loved nothing better than just to relax for a while, and to him, relaxation meant one thing: stretching out in a comfortable place with a tasty snack and a good book to read. And that was why, on that sunny Monday morning, Lewis lay comfortably stretched.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.